Along the way, we are going to encounter some very, very important lessons and principles and exhortations. And we do have some very specific objectives in this study. We are going to have a look at the true spirit of Elijah, which is why we began with 1 Kings 19. And the true spirit of Elijah was not the spirit that he manifested in his ministry, which lasted, by the way, for 3.5 years, which you'll know is picked up in Revelation chapter 11, the period of the witnesses. For 3.5 years or 1260 years using the day for a year principle. But Elijah didn't have it right, brothers and sisters, but Elisha did. You recall the words of that hymn that we sang? It said things like this: with confident and humble mind, freedom in service I would find. Now, that wasn't the mind of Elijah, but it was the mind of Elisha, who replaced him. It also said this: things deemed impossible I dare, thine is the call and thine the care. Elijah, of course, we've just read, fled after that amazing triumph on Mount Carmel, where the whole nation collapsed on its knees and said, Yahweh, he is God. What an excellent opportunity to begin the work of education. This nation was prepared, as they will be in the day when Armageddon has destroyed 2/3 in the land, and the rest of them will collapse to their knees and say, Yahweh, he's God. And you and I, along with Elijah, will get involved in the work of education, both of the Jews in the land and the Jews outside the land. Elijah ran away from that opportunity. He ran into the face of Jezebel, and she said, you killed 450 prophets and your life will be like them by this time tomorrow. And he fled for his life to Horeb. He should have stayed behind. And God dealt with him down there, brothers and sisters. He said, what on earth are you doing here? I've got 7,000 knees back there. I haven't bowed to Baal. And you've left them in the cold. Get back there. That's what he said to him. But he never did what God asked him to do, except for one thing. And he did that reluctantly. He didn't anoint Hazael king of Syria or Jehu king of Israel. And he reluctantly threw his mantle on the shoulders of Elisha. He had a lot to learn, and that's why God whipped him away, took him over to Gilead, and he spent 12 to 15 years ruminating. And when he wrote a letter to Jehoram, the son of Jehoshaphat, about 15 years after he'd been removed, he'd got it right. So when that man is raised, he'll be ready. He'll have a different spirit. And we're going to see what the spirit of Elisha was. It was the true spirit of Elijah. Is that a surprise to you? Do you think I'm too hard on Elijah? Well, hang on, because God is harder. All right, hang on. God is harder on Elijah than I am. This is the man who went down to plead that God would destroy Israel. Elisha was a man who devoted his whole life to the redemption of Israel. There's a big difference between these two men. So we're going to explore the character of Elisha, and guess what we are going to find, brothers and sisters? We're going to find the character, the foreshadowing of the work of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's where our studies will take us as we proceed over this weekend. You're pretty familiar, I think, with the chronology of the kings, and this is the area of that chronology that we're going to be dealing with. As you can see, if you can see that, you might need a telescope. But here you've got, of course, the kings of Judah, Jehoshaphat, Jehoram, Joash, etc. And in the north, you've got Ahab, his sons, and then Jehu, who destroys the house of Ahab. This is the time in which Elisha, the prophet, is called. And so we're going to have a look at that period of history in this first study, just to get the background straight, to get the context right in our minds. So Elijah and Elisha are God's men, raised up for a time of apostasy. And he always does that, doesn't he? He always raises up men at the appropriate time, of the right character. It was a great time of incredible turmoil in Israel. And assassinations of kings were quite frequent. Baasha slew Nadab, Jeroboam's son. Zimri slew Elah. He lasted 1 week and then suicided. Civil war then erupted in Israel, leading to an era of rank apostasy in the north. This was the rise of the Omrid dynasty that we're going to talk about. And the bringing in of Baal worship into Israel. This was the time when God raises up both Elijah and Elisha. They're like chalk and cheese in reality. So you can see that little area I was just talking about, this time of great confusion when there are many assassinations and there's civil war going on. Well, not long after that, in the time of Ahab, along comes Elijah, and then he's followed by Elisha. That's the area of scripture we're going to be considering. And of course, the wonderful thing about Elisha is that whereas Elijah's work was effectively only 3.5 years long, which of course prefigured the ministry of John the Baptist and also foreshadowed in a sense the 3.5 year ministry of Christ, Elisha's work went on for 5 decades, 50 years of solid work in the truth in Israel. So civil war, just a brief recounting. You might want to join me, if you would, in the 1st of Kings, chapter 16. This is the record I'm going to be focusing on for a little while. It's a record of great confusion. 1 Kings 16, verses 21 and 22 tell us about the civil war. This is after Zimri, that idiot, who assassinated his boss and then lasted 1 week and burnt the palace down over his head because he didn't want anybody else to sit in it. He was swept away. And we read in verse 21 of 1 Kings 16, "Then were the people of Israel divided into 2 parts. Half of the people followed Tibni, the son of Ginath, to make him king, and half followed Omri." Well, who would have known where that was going to lead? Well, Omri defeated the challenger, Tibni. Tibni means straw, or a man of straw. His father's name, Ginath, means a garden, and Omri means heaping. So I get a picture in my mind of this civil war, and of course Omri is the stronger character. He gets the garden rake, all right, and he rakes up the straw of the garden and puts it into a heap and puts a match to it. That's what he did. And there was a time of great violence. This is the era when callous brutality prevailed in Israel. And men were whipping up women with children and all sorts of things were going on. It wasn't a very nice time to be a Christadelphian, if you could call them that in those days. They were Christadelphians, because we know from 2 Kings 9 that God says that Israel, even in its pollution, before Jehu's work was done, he said, "They're my people. My people, Israel." All right, so they were God's people. They were just in serious trouble. Now, this character, Omri, is not given enough time in our considerations of the kings, because he was a very, very influential man. Let's have a brief word about the Omri dynasty. If you have a look at verse 23, it says, "In the 31st year of Asa, king of Judah, began Omri to reign over Israel 12 years. 6 years he reigned in Tirzah." Okay? "He purchased a prominent hill," in the next verse, "and he called it the hill of Samaria after the name of the man from whom he purchased it. Shema was his name." Now, this is going to become a very important place in the life of Elisha the prophet. Samaria. He spends quite a bit of time here. A lot of dramatic events occur in Samaria, in the life of Elisha. "But this man Omri surpassed all previous kings," verse 25 of 1 Kings 16 tells us, "in wickedness. But he was to be surpassed by his son." Whereas Omri, verse 26, promoted the religion of Jeroboam, he was a man noted for might. Have a look at the words of verse 27. We read that he was known for his might. But he only lasted 12 years, but he had set up a very powerful dynasty. That word there, might, has the idea of mastery. And mastery in warfare, he had demonstrated when he destroyed Tibni. And he was a man of incredible influence as well. So this is a map of Israel. This is the Omrid dynasty. He ruled 6 years in Tirzah and then bought the hill of Samaria, ruled there for 6 years. They had a summer palace up here in Jezreel. Now, you might remember that plays an important part when we get to the vineyard of Naboth that Ahab wanted to take over, and Naboth refuses, and then Jezebel arranges for the death, humiliating death, not only of Naboth, but of his sons as well, who would, of course, take it over if they were alive. So she gets rid of them too. And so this is the powerful dynasty of Omri. Just imagine how God felt about all this, especially when Ahab goes and takes to wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians. So here is a map of Israel, and there is Samaria here. It's about 21 miles from the Mediterranean coast. And you actually see glimpses. We were up there about 12 months ago. You can actually see glimpses of it from the hill of Samaria. And it's about 8 miles from Shechem. There's the hill of Samaria. It is quite a prominent hill in that area. I'd like you to have a look, if you would, at the prophecy of Isaiah. Isaiah 28 tells us something about how God thought of this place when Omri set up his dynasty there and Ahab replaced him in due course. And this, by the way, brethren and sisters, this section of scripture tells us why the supposed reformation, or the expected reformation of Jehu, came unstuck. We're going to see what the causes of it were, and of course that was a matter of great distress for Jehonadab, the son of Rechab, who expected that Israel would return to their roots, they'd go back to their pure religion. They didn't. Because when Jehu came to the palace of Ahab, which we'll read about shortly, he came to that palace and he found the largest wine cellar then on earth, and he saw the opulence of the life of Ahab, it killed him off. He became inebriated with the things of materialism and of the bottle. And we know that from Isaiah chapter 28. We read this in verse 1. Woe to the crown of pride, to the drunkards of Ephraim, whose glorious beauty is a fading flower, which are on the head of the fat valleys of them that are overcome with wine. And he goes on to speak about that. And of course, again, that's repeated in verse 4 about this crown of pride and their fading from the glory that they had under the reign of Omri and Ahab. So this city sat at the head of the fat valleys, we read. If you go down to verse... We read that in verse 1, didn't we? It's repeated in kind in verse 4. It sat at the head of the fat valleys. So prosperity and fruitfulness prevailed at this time. That was the thing that took them away. In 1 Kings 22:39, we read about that ivory-tipped palace. We read, now the rest of the acts of Ahab and all that he did, and the ivory house which he made, and all the cities that he built, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles? So there was this life of sumptuousness and opulence, total self-indulgence in the times that God raised up Elijah and Elisha. Now that wouldn't be like our days, would it? We wouldn't be living in days like that, would we? Yeah, well, I think we can probably see there's going to be some lessons in this for you and me. Then we come, if you come back to 1 Kings 16, we might just have a brief look at this worst king of Israel, the son of Omri. And there's something very important about a statement that's made later on in Micah chapter 6. I'm not going to take you there for the sake of time. It's on the screen behind me. Micah 6 verse 16 is one of those formulas that does service right throughout the scripture. You see, it says this, for the statutes of Omri are kept, and all the works of the house of Ahab. You've got the idea, you've got a statute maker. You've got someone who lays out a plan, a pattern, right? Then you've got someone who comes along behind him and implements it. But they're the doer. So you've got the works of the house of Ahab. So Omri was the man who used his brain and laid out the plans, and Ahab, his son, came along behind him and fulfilled them. And he went further than his father, in fact. So Ahab's name signifies the brother or friend, that is. I mean, fathers don't have sons who are brothers, do they? But yeah, that in the Hebrew, it means the brother of his father. Now, you can't get closer than that. In other words, it's saying he's the spitting image, spiritually speaking, of his father. So here was the man who implemented his father's policy. So Some suggest the name means therefore resembling the Father, and he certainly did. No question about that. We'll come to the choosing of his wife in a minute. Just another word about Micah 6 verse 16. You know where that really first comes into play? Genesis chapter 10. In Genesis chapter 10, we've got Cush, who's the father of Nimrod. Now, Cush is the great original prophet of the Babylonian mysteries. To put it in our language, he wrote the Catholic Catechism. Okay, it came from the brain of Cush. He's called Bel, which became Baal. So when you read about Baal, think Cush. Okay, there's the papal brain, so to speak, that developed the principles. He was the statute maker. Well, who came behind him? Well, the man who was the mighty hunter in the face of Yahweh, Nimrod. So you've got Cush and Nimrod. So this statement could equally apply, and I think in the mind of God it does equally apply, because you see, you find that statement in Micah. At the time when Baal worship was brought into Judah. Now, the first Babylonian apostasy was here in the days of Ahab. But 150 years later, along comes Ahaz and then his grandson Manasseh, and they bring the whole panoply of Babylonian worship into Judah. So you've got Babylonian apostasies in the north and in the south. And that's when this statement is made. You could read it this way, couldn't you? The statutes of Cush are kept, and all the works of the house of Nimrod, because the house of Nimrod was now in Judah. Well, in the days of Ahab, it ended up in the house of Israel. Very, very important little formula, that one. What, I haven't dealt with that one, you know, but I haven't dealt with 1 Kings 16. Let's just have a look at 1 Kings 16, verses 30 and 31. And Ahab the son of Omri did evil in the sight of Yahweh above all that were before him. And it came to pass, as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam the son of Nebat, that he took to wife Jezebel, who, by the way, has a name that means chaste. Not C-H-A-S-E-D. Right, she was chaste by 400 boyfriends, for sure. But chaste. Chaste as in pure. It's one of the greatest misnomers of the Bible. I'm going to meet a few misnomers as we proceed. So here he takes this woman. She's the daughter of Ethbaal, which means with or near Baal, and she never left him. And he went and served Baal and worshipped him. So when you read Baal, read Cush. This is Cush and Nimrod worship in the Ecclesia. Awful, awful things were happening in the time when God raised up Elijah and Elisha. It's very important to know the background, understand the depth of the apostasy that these two had to face. And then you can understand the timidity, the fear of Elijah. And he's face to face with this woman Jezebel. You understand that. This is what makes the character of Elisha so great. That he was not in any way deterred by Ahab or Jezebel or their successors. He faced up to that. He put his hand to the plough, and he never looked back, brothers and sisters. It's the great thing about Elisha, and there's a lot of lessons that we can learn, because I'll tell you something. I get around a little bit, as you know, and I do come across people, brethren, who are very disturbed at what's happening in our community, and some of them have developed a siege mentality. You know, they're going to sort of creep away into the back corner somewhere and throw stones over the wall at their enemies. Well, that's not the way that God wants us to handle the problems of the present. He wants us to have the spirit of Elisha. Bold, courageous, undaunted. He didn't care what they thought about him. He didn't care what the king said he would do to him. You know, when the king came down, he sent his messenger down, his executioner, to Elisha when he was in Samaria at the time of the famine. Remember that? He says, that murderer has sent his executioner down here. Hold him at the door. His master's not far behind him, and I'll deal with him when he comes. You know what Elijah would have done? He'd be on the first horse out of there. All right, that's the difference between these two men. And we have got to make up our mind what we're going to do in difficult times. Thankfully, the way I read the signs, we're not going to have to deal with it for too much longer. But whatever time is left, brothers and sisters, this is the spirit we have to have. We have to have the spirit of Elisha the prophet. We're going to learn some lessons from him. Simple lessons, by the way, but very important ones. So Jezebel's in the brotherhood. Ahab's most grievous sin was to introduce that woman into the ecclesia. And we know what our Lord Jesus Christ said about that. Jezebel's influence, of course, finally led to Athaliah reigning in Judah for 6 years, which is very appropriate, isn't it, for a Catholic? And that's what she was. She was a servant of Nimrod. Yeah, 6 years. You know what the record says about her? She reigned over the land. She did not reign over the people of the land. Twice it says that the people of the land rejoiced when Athaliah was slain. But, you know, this was to lead to the awful compromise of Jehoshaphat, which brought Baal worship into Judah and almost destroyed the line of David. They got down to 1 6-month-old baby in the line of David. So the bringing in to Israel of Jezebel prefigured the Thyatiran epoch of ecclesiastical history. You might be familiar with the writings of Brother Mansfield in relation to this. He comments on what Brother Thomas has to say in Eureka, and he's a different. And Brother Thomas says that the seven letters of the Apocalypse are prophetic of the time from John down to our day. So does Brother Mansfield. He just puts different periods in. And I think Brother Mansfield probably is correct. He refers to the Thyatiran epoch from AD 606, when the papacy came into vogue, round to 1572, when the witnesses were finally stopped from witnessing. That they weren't killed, that didn't happen until 1685, but they were effectively stopped from witnessing. That's the period that he refers to as the Thyatiran epoch. Would you come with me to 1 Chronicles 21? This is what happens when you compromise, as Jehoshaphat was to do, by marrying his son, his successor Jehoram, to Athaliah, the daughter of Ahab, and most likely of Jezebel. We're not actually specifically told that Athaliah was the daughter of Jezebel, but it's most likely she was, because she behaves exactly the same as her mother. Well, this is what happened. 1 Chronicles 21. Sorry, not 2 Chronicles. Did I say 1st? I mean 2 Chronicles 21. In 2 Chronicles 21, we read this in verse 1. Now Jehoshaphat slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David, and Jehoram his son reigned in his stead. And he had brethren, the sons of Jehoshaphat. And there, you see them listed on the screen behind me. Now, I'm going to just read these names. You'll see them up on the screen. Just notice something. You're curious here. It says, Azariah and Jehiel and Zechariah and Azariah. So we've got a second Azariah. Now, it's probably a different mother, I would suggest. And strange to have two sons named the same name in the family, isn't it? Anyway, that's what we read. And Michael and Shephatiah. All these were the sons of Jehoshaphat, king of Israel. Jehoshaphat, king of Israel? I thought he was king of Judah. Well, when you bring the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel into your ecclesia, you're going to end up like Israel. And that's what happens. All right? He's called the king of Israel. And their father gave them great gifts of silver and of gold and precious things with fenced cities in Judah. But the kingdom gave he to Jehoram because he was the firstborn. He was a man of principle. And Jehoshaphat was going to behave himself scripturally, and he did. He might have had some misgivings about Jehoram, but, well, he's the firstborn. Verse 4. Now when Jehoram was risen to the kingdom of his father, he strengthened himself and slew all his brethren with the sword. And David was also the princes of Israel. So he got rid of the advisers of Jehoshaphat, whom he didn't like, and he got rid of his brothers. And I wonder who advised him to do that. Well, I think I know. It was the daughter of Jezebel who did that, because that's exactly what Jezebel used to do. Prick Ahab, you know, go and kill him, you know. Get rid of these prophets of Yahweh. Yeah, that was what she was like. Well, guess what happens to these? All slain by Jehoram, their older brother, and then God intervenes, and the sons of Jehoram and Athaliah are taken captive by invaders and die miserably elsewhere, and their sole surviving son Ahaziah is slain by Jehu at age 22. All right, so it's a mess, an absolute mess. And the kingdom of David is in jeopardy. It's down to 1 6-month-old baby. You come to the end of we'll just pick this up at the end of 2 Chronicles 22 from verse 10. Now we're going to read about the death of Ahaziah, Athaliah's son, in a moment. But just pick up and see what happens after he's killed by Jehu. 2 Chronicles 22 verse 10. But when Athaliah, the mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she arose and destroyed all the seed royal of the house of Judah. Now here's a grandmother going around slicing the throats of her own grandchildren. You know, most grandmothers I know, they bring candies along to the meeting on Sunday. You know, and the grandkids are like swarming around like bees around a honeypot. Well, this grandmother's going around cutting the throats of her own grandchildren. What an incredible situation that is. Fortunately, of course, God intervenes. He uses the faithful sister of Ahaziah, Jehoshabeth, whose name means whose oath is Yahweh, who happens to be about 26 years of age, by the way, and she's the wife of Jehoiada the priest, who just happens to be 95 years of age, which is a curious marriage in its own right, but produces a child who has connection with royalty, David, and with the priesthood. And Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, becomes a wonderful type of our Lord Jesus Christ in the ring. But that's another subject. What I want to do is to show you what we read in verses 2 to 4. 2 to 4 of 2 Chronicles 22. This is what happens when you compromise. It says 40 and 2 years old. He was 22. You'll go to 2 Kings chapter 8 verse 26. You'll find he was 22. And you do the math, as you say in this country, he couldn't have been 42. So there's a copious error there. He was 22 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 1 year in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Athaliah, the daughter of Omri. Well, she wasn't the daughter of Omri, was she? She was the granddaughter of Omri. So why does it say the daughter of Omri? Well, you just got to read on. You get your answer, you read on. It says this. He also walked in the ways of the house of Ahab, for his mother was his counsellor to do wickedly. The next verse adds, wherefore he did evil in the sight of Yahweh like the house of Ahab, for they were his counsellors after the death of his father to his destruction. The statutes of Omri are kept, and all the works of the house of Ahab. Statute maker? Doer. Athaliah, statute maker, counsellor. Ahaziah, a son, implementer. Got the picture? See how important Micah 6 verse 16 is? God's telling you how important it is by calling her the daughter of Omri. She's not the daughter of Omri, the granddaughter, rather. That's what this is selling. And that's why, of course, when Christ picks this up in the New Testament, he says of this Jezebel class in the Ecclesia Thyatira, I'll give her a chance to repent. She didn't repent. I'll kill her children with death. I'm not quite sure what else you'd kill them with, but I will kill her children with death. He's saying the judgment is complete. All right, that's what it's saying. No recovery from that one. So when you look at Judah's spiritual state as a result of the north coming into the south, it goes to a dip here. We've got Asa's, the greatest reformation in Judah's history, followed by Jehoshaphat, who promoted his father's reformation, even though his father had failed at the end of his life. You've got Athaliah being brought in, they dip. But then Jehoiada gets involved, this man who worked, laboured for 100 years. Well, what's God doing in the north? How's he going to try and recover his people in the north? Education, just like Jehoshaphat did. Who's going to do that? Elijah? No. He's going to run away. He has to bring forth another one to do the work of education. And his name is Elisha. The salvation of Ael. The type of our Lord Jesus Christ. But there's a violent struggle for power going on in the north, isn't there? Is it Yahweh or Baal? Who would prevail in this struggle for the hearts and minds of Israel and Judah? Would it be Baal? Would it be Nimrod and Cush's father? Would it be Yahweh? Well, Elijah and Elisha were God's answer. Now, you see that plaque on the screen behind me? That's my photograph of the plaque that we photographed in 2010 in a place called Palmyra. Does that ring any bells with you, Palmyra? It's also called biblically Tadmor in the wilderness. It was the easternmost boundary of the Kingdom of Solomon. It's a fabulous oasis. It's probably 40, 50 acres of palm trees at Palmyra. Well, ISIS came there late last year or earlier this year. I forget when it was exactly. And some of the people that had served us in the cafes while we were there, I saw lying in the street and they had no heads on. And I know that they were the people because they're lying outside the cafes that we were in. Okay. ISIS came in and slide, and they started to destroy the best preserved temple of Baal in the world today. Now, I'm sorry in a way they didn't get to finish the job, but you know what I mean. But they went about destroying this artifact of, you know, the tourists go there to see. We went there to see it as well. And just next door is the Temple of Nabu. You know, the Temple of Nabu is where we get Nebuchadnezzar from. Okay, so pretty significant places. Anyway, this was the struggle going on. So God raises up Elijah the Tishbite. Have a look at 1 Kings chapter 17, where he bursts into the ivory palace of Ahab like a thunderbolt out of Gilead, this rugged prophet who was to be a forerunner of John the Baptist. So there you have in that record of 1 Kings chapter 17, and at verse 1 we read this. You know, we don't know of this man prior to this. It's just out of the blue. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as Yahweh Elohim of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And we know that came to pass for 3.5 years. There was famine. Just like Revelation 11 says of the witnesses, these have power to shut heaven, that it not rain in the days of their prophecy. And we're told how long that was. 3.5 years, 1260 years. All right, in biblical terms. So we know that record of the apocalypse is based on what happens here in the work of Elijah. But his mission failed. He was Yahweh's witness to pronounce judgment on Ahab's house. His triumph on Mount Carmel should have culminated in the destruction of Baal worship. It didn't. Elijah's sense of isolation and fear of Jezebel led to the failure of his mission. So the events on Horeb, of which we read in 1 Kings 19, and that's, of course, very close to where you are, those events are very important. They're designed to find another way. And that other way is to be through Elisha. So let's come and have a very brief look at 1 Kings 19. It can be slightly more longer than what I thought it might be, given the time. But you know the story. I don't need to tell you the story, do I? He has this marvellous victory in 1 Kings 18 on Carmel. He races before the chariot of Ahab. I mean, this is inhuman, isn't it? You can't run in front of a chariot and galloping. But he did. And of course, there's this thunderous rain to break the famine. I mean, what events are these? 450 prophets having their blood washed away in the brook Kishon. They're dead as a doornail. All right. This was ground. This was fertile ground. This was the time to break up your fallow fields and to sow righteousness, isn't it? What does he do? He runs away. Verse 3, 1 Kings 19. And when he saw that he arose and went for his life. His life? Are we here for our life, brothers and sisters? Have you been called to the truth so you can have your life? Or have you been called to follow the man who gave his life? Well, I think I know what the answer to that is. But Elijah didn't know this yet. He didn't understand this yet. He had a siege mentality. He had that kind of thinking which said, I'm the only Christadelphian standing for the truth. All the rest are apostates. You know when Obadiah came at him and said, have you ever heard that I risked my life to preserve 100 prophets of Yahweh from the machinations of Jezebel? He didn't even know him, and nor did he really care. That has to be changed. And that's what this is about. That's what 1 Kings 19 is about. It's the beginning of the process of changing that attitude. We don't live for ourselves. He went for his life. Look at verse 4. But he himself, middle of verse 4, he requested for himself, take away my life, for I am not better than, of course he wasn't better than his fathers, and none of us are. You see, when you look at the record carefully, you read it carefully, and you see what God wants us to understand by this, he's telling us, that's not the way I want you to be. Yes, have the zeal of Elijah. Have his dedication to one thing. But never get to the point where your siege mentality says, I'm the only Christadelphian alive that's worth saving. You know why he went down to Horeb? Well, we're told. Romans 11 verses 2 to 4, we are told he went down there to plead for Yahweh to destroy Israel. He wanted the whole lot wiped out. Now if you don't think this is happening in the modern time, let me tell you it is. Alright, so we've got to get this right. It's not the way God wants us to be. Defend the truth to your last drop of blood, for sure. But make sure that your objective is to save as many people as you can in the process. That's what Elisha did. He was fearless when it came to standing up for what God stood for. He would never compromise. But he was a man who was out there to save people. Right? That is the spirit we have to have. Am I on my hobby horse here, Brother Joe, do you think? Probably not. Because you'll find that if you look at what I've just been doing in the schools of the prophets, we've been dealing with the kings of Israel and Judah, it's much the same. I get a little bit carried away. But I won't retract anything I said. Okay? Nothing. Where was I up to? Let's have a look at what happens to Elijah here in verse 9. He gets to Horeb. In his mind, I only am left. I'm going to ask God to destroy these people. Verse 9, he came thither unto a cave and lodged there, and behold, the word of Yahweh came to him, and he said unto him, what on earth are you doing here, Elijah? He said, well, I've been very jealous, the word means zealous, for Yahweh Elohim of armies. Notice the title, destructive, yeah. For the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, which was true for many of them, and thrown down thine altars and slain thy... That was true. And I only am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And God says, nonsense. That's what he says, nonsense. So he said, now you get out in the front of that cave. I think it's the same cave that Moses was in, by the way, in Exodus 33. You get out in the front of that cave. So he goes out in the front of the cave. Verse 11, go forth and stand upon the mount before Yahweh, and behold, Yahweh passed by. And a great and strong wind rent the mountains and brake in pieces the rocks before Yahweh. But he was not in the wind. Now we've got to get this right. This is not, to be honest, it's not all that well understood. It says that a great and mighty wind passed by. Now, was this a normal wind? Of course it wasn't. Have you seen a wind that's breaking rocks, shattering rocks in pieces? Doesn't happen, does it? But it happened here. So this is divine power. This is an expression, miraculous divine power is at work. So is Yahweh in that? Well, of course he's in that. But then it says this. He passed by in that wind, and it says, but Yahweh was not in the wind. Now that doesn't mean he wasn't in it. What it means is that when the wind passed by, you couldn't find him. He's gone. He's gone in that wind. It stopped breaking rocks. It's finished. So Yahweh was not there. He was gone. Then it's followed, of course, as you know, by earthquake, which passes by, and then by fire, which passes by. But there's something else here, isn't there? See down there in verse 12 and 13 it says this, and after the earthquake a fire, but Yahweh was not in the fire. And after the fire a still small voice. It's not a great translation in the King James. It is as on the screen, a much better translation. It was the voice of a gentle whisper, which I find difficult, by the way. the voice of a gentle whisper. And it kept on saying over and over again, Elijah, what are you doing here? Elijah, what are you doing here? Got a picture? And it took him a while to hear. See what it says in verse 13? It was so when Elijah, it says in my Bible, heard it, but the word it is in italics, you can cross it out. It means when Elijah finally heard. You know what it's like when you get a thunderous noise in your ears? Right? And secondly, he was no longer out at the front of the cave. And this voice was coming from outside. He was back in the back of the cave and he had his mantle over his head. So he's got something over his ears. Takes him a while. Oh, I wonder what that is. It was the persistent voice of the gentle whisper of God's voice. It represents, of course, in our time, the word of our God. Which is very gentle, isn't it? And you read it day after day, and it's just like a voice of a gentle whisper. It's very persistent. It never gives up, and it never says anything different. You know, you always get the same message, don't you? And it's attacking our weaknesses, yeah? Because it wants us to change and be better. Yeah, that's what it is. And that's what's happening to Elijah. What are you doing here? So what does he do? Well, he gives the same ridiculous soliloquy in verse 14, that he's the only one left. He was rattled. He was utterly rattled. You've been rattled in your time? Yeah, he was rattled. It's going to take him a while, and God knows that. So he sends him on his way. So what's he going to do? Verse 15 onwards, he's going to anoint Hazael. You know where the winds came into Israel from? From Syria. Yeah, and that's where Hazael was. He was the king of Syria. So here's the wind that was to come into Israel as a judging wind to break and smash like the wind had done on Mount Horeb. Then there was to be the anointing of Jehu. He says, you go on your way and I want you to anoint Hazael to be king of Syria and I want you to anoint Jehu to be king of Israel. Jehu brought about the greatest earthquake, the greatest political earthquake in Israel's history. He completely turned the nation upside down and destroyed the whole house of Ahab and every Baal worshipper. It was a great earthquake. And then would come Elisha, the son of Shaphat. You ever wonder why it talks about him being the son of Shaphat? Well, it means judge. And one of Elisha's first works was a work of judgment. Remember the 42 blasphemous ewes? We'll just briefly consider them in our study. He was slain by two she-bears. Yeah, his first work was a work of judgment. Okay. He's going to have a bit to do with that too. But he's got a lot more important work than that. Because Elisha is going to be prophet, teacher, in your room. And he's going to go to those 7,000 in Israel who haven't bowed their knee to Baal. And he's going to educate them, which you can do. So when you go back, you anoint him. He's going to take over from you, Elijah. You've got a little bit of ruminating to do. When I whip you away and take you back to Gilead, you can sit there around your campfire and think about all this because I want you to be ready. You are going to be the leader of the second Exodus of Israel. And when you do that job, Elijah, you're not going to believe that you're the only Christadelphian left that's worth saving. You're going to believe that you can recover them all. You won't, but you're going to believe it. And you're going to work like that, and he will, brothers and sisters, when he's raised from the dead, and he's sent forth along with many of you, and will go forth with him in that work, he will have a different attitude. And that comes through the letter he wrote 12 or 15 years after, when he wrote to Jehoram, the king of Judah. You can see the change in that man's attitude. He commends Asa. He commends Jehoshaphat. All right? He would never have done that. No way would he have done that when he was in his 3.5 year ministry. Elisha is to become the voice of a gentle whisper in Israel. So let's get on with, very quickly, get on with his appointment, his commission. Now, it's a fascinating thing that Elijah performed only one of the tasks assigned to him by Yahweh at Horeb. And that was to anoint Elisha as prophet in his room. It was Elisha who anointed Hazael to be king over Syria. It was Elisha who also anointed Jehu to be king over Israel. So Elijah didn't do those things. It was left to Elisha. But it was Elijah, of course, who anointed Elisha first. And Elisha lived at a place called Abel Mahola, the meadow of dancing. And the reason that they danced there, of course, was very productive. I went there once, and black soil, and you could grow anything there. You know, it's a place where you put something in the ground, boom, up she comes, because all of the soil has been brought down by the Jordan over the centuries. So it's a wonderful place. And I guess where you find what you find Elisha doing when Elijah arrives. Well, he's ploughing with 12 yoke of oxen. See the record here in 1 Kings 19 and verse 19. So he departed thence and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was ploughing with 12 yoke of oxen before him. Notice that? He wasn't out front. He was out back. What do you reckon he was out back? Well, if you're out the back, you can watch the people in front of you. So why is there 12 yoke? Well, because this is the 12 tribes of Israel, see? And this is the character of the man that God wants. He wants a man who's going to be there supervising, guiding. Hey, you up there, number four. You're out of line. Got a picture? A man who's going to control the ploughing of the fallow ground in Israel. He's going to cast in seed and get some produce, just like he's done naturally for many years in his hometown. He's going to do this for the nation. He with the 12. They still do this today. You can go down to South America and find people pulling, you know, ploughs like this behind animals. So it still happens today. And so Elijah comes along and he throws his mantle over. I don't have time to take you to Zechariah 13 verse 4, but this is post-Armageddon, Zechariah 13 verse 4. We read that when the saints are educating the one-third who survive the events of Armageddon, there are going to be idiots among the Jews who survived, who will want to prophesy and teach their own things. You know what it says about them? They're going to be dealt with by mum and dad. And it says they will not wear a rough garment to deceive. So a rough garment, like the one that Elijah had, like his mantle, the top garment, was the symbol of his prophetic office. And when he comes along and he throws that over the shoulders of Elisha, he's saying, you're going to take over from me. That's what you're going to do. You're going to take over from me. Look what Elisha does, verse 20. It says, Elijah passed by. That's wonderful words. We'll make a brief comment about that in a minute. He passed by him, just like the wind, earthquake and fire passed by on the mountain, remember? And what's left? Still small voice. Elijah just keeps going. And Elisha is left here to tidy up and run after him. Elijah's not going to stop. So what does he do? He says to Elijah in verse 20, let me, I pray thee, kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow thee. And he said unto him, go back again, for what have I done to thee? And he returned back from him and took a yoke of oxen, slew them, boiled their flesh with the instruments. In other words, he's saying, you see these oxen here that I've been using to pull a plough? You see this plough here made out of wood? We're going to use the wood to burn the oxen in a sacrifice. We're going to have a fellowship meal here because this is the end of my career as a farmer. All right? I'm finished. I'm finished as a farmer. From now on, I'm going to be ploughing in men's minds. That's what he's saying. And that's what he did. You know, can you remember Luke 9? You want to have a flick at you? Can you use two hands and come to Luke 9? You know, we'll be in Luke 9 in our next study as well, God willing. Remember Luke 9 and how this three men come to Christ at the end of the chapter? Some are volunteers and some are conscripts. So you have in verse 57 of Luke 9, it says, and it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. And he could see straight through this man. He knew he was a feather pillow man. You know, he loved his thick mattress and his feather pillow, and he said to him, you're not ready to follow me. The Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. He saw straight through him. He's a comfortable Christadelphian. He's the one who wants the easy jobs in the ecclesia. Okay? Verse 59. And he said unto another, follow me. But he said, Lord. Now, there's a very important word here, and it's used again in verse 61. It's the most important word in this context. But he said, Lord, suffer me first. Got that? The word first. Suffer me first. It's a matter of priorities, isn't it? He said, I want to go and bury my father. Now, the Lord says, well, yeah, I can understand that. You have obligations to your parents, that's true. But you know, his father might not have been dead yet. What he's really saying is, well, I've got to wait till my dad kicks the bucket, and then I'll bury him, and then I'll come and... That could be 10 or 15 years. Right? He says, you let the dead, the spiritually dead, bury their literal dead. And you come and follow me. Then the next man, 61. Another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me... Look at the word. Let me first go bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. And Christ says to him in verse 62, Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plough and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. He sees straight through him. What he's saying is, you know, farewells in those days, farewells in ancient times could last for months, couldn't they? You know, you go back to the record of Genesis 24, 55 and Judges 19, 1 to 10, they could go on for weeks or months. This man is saying, well, look, I'd like to go home and say goodbye to my parents. What he meant was, I'll see you in a year's time. And Christ says, you're not worthy to follow me. You put your hand to the plough, you're a volunteer, then you'll stick with it. So what is Elisha's request wrong? Back here in 1 Kings 19? Delay was clearly the motive of the man in Luke 9:61, and Elijah knew that delay was not Elisha's motive. And that's why he says to him, go back again. He gives him permission. Christ didn't give permission to the man in Luke 9, did he? But Elijah gives permission to Elisha because he knows that his motivation is right. And he says this to him, for what have I done to thee? And the Companion Bible says, what is the meaning of what I did? In other words, he exhorts him to consider the purpose of casting his mantle on him. And so he makes sacrifice. He leaves his old job behind. Elijah's passed by, and that phrase passed by the way, we don't have time now, it's well over time. We don't have time to deal with that, brothers and sisters, but that is the key. That is the key to the transfiguration of Christ. This is why Moses and Elijah are with our Lord Jesus Christ on the mountain. The incidents in Exodus 33, 34, and this one in 1 Kings 19 are the basis of the choice of those two men at the transfiguration. I just want to conclude by summarising. Elijah and Elisha as types. Elijah was a type of John the Baptist who came in the spirit and power of Elijah. Elisha was a type of Christ, the still small voice of God in Israel. Elijah's work was primarily about warning of impending judgment, but was to include teaching like John. Now, Elisha's mission included acts of judgment. It was primarily about education and spiritual guidance. And we are going to see a wonderful man, a wonderful servant of our God as we proceed in our studies.